Some of the extra credit stuff.
Yeah.
Hello, everybody.
Hello.
Good evening. Thank you all so much for coming. I know you are all just as excited as I am to hear from our four finalists tonight. So especially for the newer students, I just want to give you a quick intro as to the idea behind this competition. So this is the fourth year, fourth annual MacLean Science Lecture Competition. This competition was named in honor of legendary, now retired, St. Andrew's life science teacher, Dr. Peter MacLean, who was, and some of the seniors and possibly juniors will remember Dr. MacLean as being this incredibly passionate, outspoken advocate for nature and taking care of our planet. And we just so valued his passion, his, desire to just continuously communicate with the whole school about the importance of taking care of our Earth. So this competition was named in his honor, and what we are looking for in our finalists and what you're all going to enjoy from them tonight is that they have developed both a mastery of an area of science that is of particular interest to them. So they have chosen this independently. This isn't something that they've ever studied in a class. They've sort of taken the initiative to research and learn about it themselves. And they're also going to be communicating it to you in a way that we hope will be accessible and interesting and engaging and inspiring for everybody, whether you are a third former or whether you are one of the science faculty, okay? So we're really, this is the sort of criteria we're going for. It is a competition, okay? So we did have 10 entrants that made it through to this final. Tonight we're really just going to focus on hearing and celebrating our four finalists. After tonight, we'll have a panel of judges that will go away and deliberate and try and choose, very hard decision always, one overall winner, which we'll announce at school meeting next week, okay? So we get to celebrate the winner next week. But tonight, we're celebrating all four of our finalists. Our judging panel is over here. We have science faculty, and we also have, and I think we should give a round of applause to Pearl Malik, who was last year's winner. Without any further ado, I think I'm going to hand it over to our first speaker, Adele. A round of applause, please.
Nerve detecting for science, replicating human touch. This is Hannah. Hannah's my older sister, and she was diagnosed with cerebral palsy when she was a newborn. Cerebral palsy is a condition where you cannot walk, nor can you talk. The world is not built for people like Hannah. And so, in order to adapt to a world that is not built for her, she uses multiple types of equipment, including her wheelchair, seen here, her Toby, which helps her speak, a beach wheelchair, which helps her go down to the water, a rocking chair that she sits in every night, and a special bicycle that helps her bike when we are at the beach. Because of Hannah's disability, I have always been very interested in adaptive technology. My mother, who's an art historian, and I have worked with a foundation called Adaptive Design Association for many years, and they design a lot of low-tech adaptive technology. They use cardboard to build this rocking chair. They also build stools, and they run various forms of classes. Because I've had all this experience with low technology adaptive, equipment, I wanted to spend some time researching a high technology adaptive equipment. And by through that, I landed on prosthetics. Modern day advanced prosthetics usually include a socket which attaches onto the remnant limb and is controlled using electrodes placed on the skin. However, this technology is quite flawed because the socket, when it attaches onto your arm, can cause blistering and different rashes and is generally very uncomfortable. The electrodes, which takes electrical signals from the remnant limb in order to control the prosthetic, vary in their placement from day to day. They are also not integrated directly into the muscle, and therefore they have a hard time picking up those signals, and the prosthetic has a hard time adapting and working on its own. 41% of surveyed amputees have abandoned prosthetics such as these because of their limited functional gain. So what's the solution? Neuroprosthetics. A neuroprosthetic is any kind of device that enhances or enhances a neural input or output. This guy, Max Ortiz Catalan, wrote a research paper entitled Self-Contained Neuromuscular Arm Prostheses, where he researched a specific new type of neuroprosthetic entitled the E-OBRA, and he found that this prosthetic is both safe and reliable in the long run. I will now talk about the E-OBRA and the benefits that it has. So the E-OBRA is a multiple part system. It has a fixture, which is right in the center, and then it operates bidirectionally. So information is sent down from the brain to the arm, and the tactile information gets sent right back up to the brain. First, let's discuss the integration fixture. So as opposed to the socket prosthetic, which is fit over the limb, the E-OBRA has a titanium screw that is also integrated directly into the bone. This gets rid of any uncomfortable blisters that the socket introduces into the arm. That fixture is then connected to an abutment, which juts out and is what connects to the actual prosthetic. Around the muscle are the various electrodes. And again, electrodes are a little tiny electrical conductor placed right directly into the muscle that can both take electrical information from outside and send it up and receive electrical information from the brain. The abutment is then attached to multiple commercially produced prosthetics, such as the AeroArm and the Sensor Hand. However, these prosthetics do have to be specially altered in order to contain an interface that will then process the electrical signals, and so that is a cost issue that needs to be considered. I'm now going to talk about the bidirectional functions of the E-OBRA. So the information sent from the brain and the information sent from the hand. First, we'll start with the information sent from the brain and the way we control our limbs usually. So there's the central nervous system, which is centered at the brain and the spinal cord, and this is kind of the control center of our bodies. This is where all of our motion signals come from and where all information ends back up. So the brain will send a neuron down, will send electrical signals through neurons, which are just charged cells, and they'll send them through the peripheral nervous system in order to reach your hands, your legs so that you can run, your arms so that you can play foosball and Amos. And through these charged signals, information is passed, and that information is passed. In the E-OBRA, you're not sending information into a limb. You have to send it through the interface. So the information starts from your brain in the neuron, just as it does in the biological process, see, and gets sent down all the way through to the interface through those various charged signals, in which, in the interface, in that attachment system with the abutment and the fixture. It gets integrated through the electrodes and sent into the arm. That interface in the arm tells the arm what to do. So you can see here, the man is opening and closing his wrist, and you can see the prosthetic on the other side replicating that same motion because the information has managed to come down through the brain, through the electrode into the interface, and then the hand moves just as a biological hand does. You can see that there is a small time delay, which is something to be considered, but hopefully as time goes on, that time delay will be improved. The second part of the eOPRA is the tactile information sent back up through the artificial limb into the brain. Usually, in a biological system, when a force is applied, little nerve endings called mechanoreceptors receive that pressure from the nerves, and as that pressure intensifies, there's a voltage increase. So there's simply more electrical information in the hand the harder that something is pressing on it. When a certain threshold is reached, the neurons send electrical signals back up to the brain, processing in the same way that information is sent down from the brain. Electrical signals are sent from one neuron up to the next, and it slowly works up your arm into your head. Again, in the eOPRA, you don't have those biological functions, and so they have to be replicated through technology. When either a low force or a high force is applied, there are three different parts, and these parts closely mimic the biological functions. There is the resistive pressure sensors, which acts as the mechanoreceptors. There's the ring oscillator, which acts as a neuron. And then that gets sent up through a synaptic transistor, which is the same kind of communication method of the neurons have biologically. The way this works is that when a force gets applied to the pressure sensor, that pressure sensor is able to turn mechanical stress into electricity and therefore change that have that same voltage change that tells the ring oscillator to start sending frequencies up to the brain. The harder a frequency is, the more frequent a frequency is, the harder the touch that is registered. So you can see here that there is the person picking it up, they have control, they sense, and you can see that kind of voltage changing here. In these two diagrams, the voltage is going up as the pressure is applied, and that information, that voltage change, gets sent back through the interface, goes through the electrodes, and into your neurons that get sent up. So what does the eOPRA mean? No matter how Max Ortiz-Catalan, the same guy who ran the study, says that no matter how sophisticated a neural interface becomes, it can only deliver real benefits to patients if the connection between the patient and the prosthetic is safe and reliable in the long run. In order for this prosthetic to actually work, people must be able to actually use it. The study that he did, all four participants in the study found that it was a safe and effective method that they could use for many weeks and years after they had the implant done. But we must seriously consider the way that we design our technology in order to be beneficial solely for the user, regardless of how futuristic or cool a technology must be. If people cannot use this technology, then there's no point in having it, as it is to help people adapt to the world. This kind of user-based technology then gets us thinking about something that Sarah Hendren wrote in a book called What Can the Body Do? How We Need the Built World. She says, these are stories about people, extended with prosthetic parts. The technologies that gave rise to them are functional, but they're also social, and the very meaning of disability is too. All of our bodies tell stories, and the materials around us shape the potential of what we can do with our bodies. If the world is not built for you, you're going to struggle getting through it. And so you need to have these prosthetics that can kind of lift you to that same potential. The prosthetic is functional, but it also helps you interact with the community around you. The prosthetic takes on almost a life bigger than just the person itself, and we need to keep remembering that that person exists. There's this entrancement with the prosthetic, with the liveliness of the machine, because it seems so alive. It can listen to our brain, it can sense touch. And so we must keep thinking about the actual person behind it and the person that needs to use this technology. Evolution is no longer just a biological process. It's also a technological one too. We can use technology to help speed up biology, to help improve biology. And so as we move into the future of science and artificial intelligence, there are new limbs that are completely artificially controlled. Controls the artificial intelligence. What does this mean for humanity? And are we becoming a blend of biology and technology? Thank you.
So we do have a few minutes for questions. Does anyone have a question that they would like to ask Adele?
And good job.
I just have a question about. Okay, can I just stop?
Yeah.
This isn't so much about the technology or the science behind it as much as it is kind of a more economic standpoint and the practicality of it. I assume, and I think you kind of touched on this in your speech. Like these kind of prosthetics can tend to be, like when they're of this sort of caliber, kind of expensive. You have, like, it doesn't have to be like a fully baked answer, but even if it's like an inkling of an idea of how, like, technology can go in a certain direction where these are more kind of, like, available for, like, cheaper. Or just, yeah, it's more applicable to, like, your normal hospital.
Yeah, so I think that ties back really nicely to the user-oriented design. This is pretty expensive as of right now. You have to get a surgery, you have to recover from the surgery. The commercial prosthetics that the EOBRA is attached to need to be altered in order to fit the EOBRA. So that is a huge concern as of right now, is that it isn't quite an expensive option. But there's a lot of work being done with other various types of prosthetics. I know I watched actually a TED talk that my mother sent me today about how they're designing like $80, I think it was knees. So just kind of, we need to be thinking about the cost, and yes, that is a very big concern, but it is expensive as of right now, which is a drawback.
Any other questions?
Yes, sure. So, Adele, is there any certain age that the prosthetic like needs to have? Like, I'm assuming it's different, like for a child or like your sister versus an adult. So, is there a certain age like limit or gap?
No. So, as far as the way that I have understood the research that I've done, is that when you first start meeting with the designers and undergoing the surgery, they extract your, they like take neuron extractions, and they do tests to figure out how your muscles react when you tell your muscle to do something, and so that would be user specific, regardless of age.
One more question.
Just to build off that question, is your prosthetic being replaced ask, does that affect like how big your prosthetic is? Because I can imagine your prosthetic would be proportional to the rest of your body, your rest of the body, your prosthetic.
Yes, can I just repeat the question, because I'm not sure we would have heard it at the back. The question is whether the age, your age would affect the kind of prosthetic that you would receive.
Just building off of Caroline's, like, you have to change it.
Right, so does the prosthetic have to be changed as you age?
So that's one of the, Hans was kind of in two parts. That's one of the fundamental downsides of the socket prosthetic that I talked about in the beginning, that does have to be replaced with age. But the OPRA is osseointegrated, so that means that it's implemented directly into your bone, so the bone can kind of grow around it. So the only part that would have to be replaced as it got older would be that kind of commercially produced limb that I discussed, just to make it kind of proportional to your size. But again, the way that I've understood the papers that I've read is that it does not need to be replaced as often as some of these other technologies do.
Maybe one more. Was there another one? Okay. Felt like I was missing someone. We good? Okay. All right. One more round of applause.
Okay, so anyone like to guess who this man Alan Turing.
Yes. So this is Alan Turing, also known as the father of modern computer science. So Alan Turing was an English mathematician, computer scientist, and logician. He was trying to solve the Einstein's problem, which is a complex puzzle given to him by his professor, and in the process of solving this problem, he actually created something called the Turing machine. So what the Turing machine is it is a mathematical model of a hypothetical computing machine, which can use a predefined set of rules to determine a result from a set of input values. This is according to Oxford Dictionary. He also later created the Turing test, which laid the foundation of artificial intelligence. Then there's also John McCarthy, who gave artificial intelligence its name around 1955. He was a Stanford professor. Okay, so now let's get into artificial intelligence. So, artificial intelligence is the intelligence of computer systems, machines, neural networks, and algorithms, which model biological creatures' ability to process information and come to a conclusion. So, some very popular artificial intelligence systems are Siri, Alexa, Google Assistant. Artificial intelligence is used by Boston Dynamics to help the robots make decisions when it comes to the robots interacting with the world around them. And so, now let's get into neural networks, which is a subset of artificial intelligence. So, what is a neural network? So a neural network is a computer system. This computer system that allows input to go through multiple layers of equations and algorithms to create an output, and it is modeled to function like the human brain's neurons. So right here is IBM's example of a simplified neural network. And so as you can see here on the input layer, what that is pretty much that's where you would maybe input the for instance, let's say I'm inputting a neural network for facial identification. Shout out to Jack Ross for giving me that idea. So let's say the neural network knows how to recognize my face. So what's going to happen here is I'm going to put my face into the input layer. Now the multiple hidden layers are going to be able to deduct whether does my face have black hair or blah, blah, blah. And pretty much what's going to happen is it's going to go through those different possibilities to come out with the output layer, which is going to have the actual solution. So now to Boston Dynamics. Boston Dynamics was founded by Mark Railbert on November 6, 1992. He is currently the president of Boston Dynamics and was formerly an MIT professor for electrical engineering and computer science. Boston Dynamics used to actually manufacture robots for the military, but had cut ties with them, and because of that, they now need a new source of income because they are mainly a research company. And so Hyundai has recently bought 80% of Boston Dynamics, and because of that, they now own controlling interest. So, athletic intelligence. The athletic intelligence these robots operate with is, well, the artificial intelligence these robots operate with is athletic intelligence, which is different than purely just cognitive intelligence because of the fact that these robots' main thought processes, if you would call them, is just how they will move around in the world. And so athletic intelligence is the knowledge to move in ways that we do, except what we do is we do it subconsciously, obviously. Like for instance, if I'm walking, my legs, I'm naturally gonna walk straight because that's what I inherently know to do. If I'm walking upstairs, I'm going to lift my leg, stagger in about a 70-degree angle and go up the stairs. And so pretty much these robots are trained with this athletic intelligence. That way they are programmed with a navigation map. They also have LiDAR sensors, 3D sensors, cameras, and also, So these robots also have a trajectory library, and that is, it pretty much is a place in the robot where they store the information of what they succeeded or didn't succeed in the past. So it's kind of like a human's trial, like normal thought process when it comes to trial and error. So let's say that the robot was walking up a set of stairs, went up with the wrong leg, sort of fell, the robot's gonna remember that, and the next time it's going up the stairs, it's gonna try to correct itself. So now, let's get into many people typically think of when you think of robots and artificial intelligence, evil robot concept. So that is pretty much the idea of robot revolution, or the idea that robots will bring about in mankind. And actually, when Boston Dynamics released their when they released their robot Spot, Black Mirror on Netflix released an episode called Metalhead inspired by the robot. So what was happening was that the robot, similar to this robot Spot, was pretty much ending the human race with multiple. So the sci-fi category of the evil robot is highly improbable, if not possible. And as humans, we do have a tendency to look at inanimate objects as if they will contribute, as if they will have human traits. And this is called anthropomorphism. So anthropomorphism is the attribution of human characteristics or behaviors to maybe a god, animal, or inanimate object. Ethical principles. So, as I previously mentioned, Boston Dynamics developed robots for the military. These robots were Big Dog and also Pack Mule. These robots, however, since Boston Dynamics has ties with the military, they no longer weaponize their, they no longer allow the robots to be weaponized, and their robots are also not allowed to have any autonomous targeting systems. Buyers are also not allowed to weaponize the robots. So, now let's actually get into the robots of Boston Dynamics. So first, I'll be talking about Spot. Spot is the robot dog that Boston Dynamics actually is selling. Spot is about 7.5 inches tall, 69.9 pounds, and Spot can move at a speed of 3.6 miles per hour. So this right here is a video of Spot in action. So as you can see, Spot is moving on a train. Spot is knowing what it wants to do. Next, I'll be talking about Atlas, which is actually the most dynamic human robot, or the Boston Dynamics. And so, Atlas is 5 feet tall, weighs 190 pounds. Atlas can also move at 5.59 miles per hour. And Atlas is also equipped with 28 hydraulic joints that are powered by its valves, also its hydraulic power unit and battery. First, I'm really going to go into hydraulics a bit to further explain that. So what that is it's a branch of science that deals with practical applications such as the transmission of energy or the effects of flow of liquids such as water and motion. So as you can see it on the example in the far right, what's happening is there is liquid inside that tube, and now the area of the original force is pushing down to lift that car up. So that's a simplified example of how hydraulics works. And so Atlas actually has fluids inside its limbs and the other body parts that travel through its quote unquote bones, which allow it to move its limbs in more advanced ways. So as I was saying before, Atlas has three computers, but it also has limitations as you'd expect, because having all that technology in the one robot tends to have problems. So Atlas is perception. So Atlas is equipped with RGB lights and also depth sensors that allow us to generate point clouds of the environment and surroundings. So what you're seeing here is Atlas' vision and what it really is seeing. Two people standing right there. And then on the far right picture, the green footsteps is where Atlas is programmed to land. So let's say, for example, someone is pushing Atlas in the front. Now let's imagine there's a green footstep behind. Atlas is going to know to stagger right back. And that is an example of his buddy's components. So right here, this is a video of how Atlas actually looks. So, as I mentioned, Spot is actually being sold for around $74,000 to $75,000 because of its high price. Obviously, not many are actually being sold. Atlas is only for research right now, and by that, what they really are doing is they're kind of just testing the limits and seeing what they can really do and how advanced they can make that robot. And now, how are these robots going to contribute to our society? So, the first way is through common labor. So, Boston Dynamics also has a robot called Stretch. Stretch already began working in warehouses. You can see right there.
So what Stretch does is pretty much is equipped with a robotic arm that allows it to pick up objects, and it also does it with smart grips, which is able to carry about 50 pounds. And then there's also Amazon's warehouse robot, which is powered, which is supplied by computer systems. This robot is not obvious. It's obviously not cross dynamics, but is a very capable engine, because this robot pretty much goes under storage units. It takes the containers, as you can see here, with the packages inside them, and transfers them to the next place they're supposed to be. However, there are a lot of ethical concerns with robots working in this, because of the fact that it's going to take away jobs from them. One of the next ways that robots are contributing is emergency response. So, due to spot finding capabilities, it already has them. Due to spot finding capabilities, it already has begun being used by both the police department and the fire department. This is because Spot has specialized sensors and also cameras and X-ray devices. It is also able to detect hazardous materials, toxic gases, and nuclear and radiological material. Spot is also equipped to measure oxygen levels to detect explosive substances or areas. And many police stations are planning to use Spot to de-escalate oxygen scenarios. That way, they can use the robots that actually have to find workers in those situations. And the NYPD actually started using Spot already. However, they received a lot of backlash because many people found it free. Because of this, Boston Image was a statement that police departments use Spot to inspect suspicious packages and environments for hazardous materials or explosives, assess hostile threats to one and to search structurally dangerous environments in emergency response areas. We believe that our robot can be used to keep our first responders and the public safe. This is probably the most important way that that robot is being used. Boston Dynamics isn't actually doing anything in the field of medical response right now, but robotic prosthetics and nerve connection, which is similar to what Adele was actually talking about, where pretty much what happens is that some robots are being created in which they connect to the disconnected, well, their sensors connect to the disconnected nerves in a person's limb, and which the arms are, let's say fingers, are able to know when that certain nerve is being moved. That way they can work the same way. This robotic limb also has more enhanced mobility than typical recurring prosthetic. And also surgical precision is a big reason why these robots are being used more, as you can see in the image in the bottom left. The robots, well, many robots have much more precise, many robots are much more accurate when it comes to surgical situations, and they can also perform these duties on a much smaller scale than humans can because of our fingers. Then AIs are also being used to make diagnoses or to help diagnoses because of the fact that they can process information quicker than humans can. And also they have access to a lot. And finally, space travel. So, Spot is built to navigate through difficult terrains, and because of this, they're testing it to use it in active Mars, actually. And so what they're going to replace the rovers that they typically have with Spot because of its legs, which allow it to have a much, well, it's capable of going to much more different landscapes and terrains. It's much more rover. It's also 2.1 miles faster than a typical rover, and these will benefit us on planets like Mars because of this, we'll be able to cover more land and learn more about the planet outside of Mars in general. And so, one of my favorite ways that these robots are being used is this one right here.
You broke my heart, because I couldn't dance. Shake them down.
Do you love me? I can really move. Do you love me? I'll get the groove. Do you love me? Now.
and the future of robotics and artificial intelligence together play a great role in helping our world develop as a society in general. Jeff Bezos also stated that we are at the beginning of the golden age of AI. Recent advancements have already led to the invention that previously lived in the realm of science fiction. We've only scratched the surface of what's possible. And that is my conclusion.
I'm not sure if this is going to work this time. We'll try it out. Questions for Derek? Hi Derek. So this is kind of a tough question, but just going back to your idea about AIs and how those start to take over the common labor aspect, how do you think that's going to affect like the future generations to come when those jobs kind of go back down or go up to robots?
Yeah, so what many people think is that more jobs will open up because of the fact that now there are going to be more robots doing jobs, because more people will be pursuing engineering and robotics. However, people that tend to make these statements are the ones who are benefiting from this new robot in jobs environment. So it is interesting to see that maybe it would be better if, well, at least personally, I think it would be better if instead of manufacturing robots to work in workplaces, it would be better to maybe go into space travel or medical research instead.
Another question. Hi there, thank you for your presentation, that was wonderful. My question is mainly about the space exploration aspect, and I'm just curious how AI can adapt to atmosphere and conditions that will be other than Earth-like.
Yeah, so what the robots Spot and Atlas already have, as I mentioned, is the trajectories trajectory system. So pretty much what the robots can do is that when they are in a situation, let's say they're on a planet where the gravity is lighter or something, and they maybe start to fall. So what's going to happen is after that happens, they will try and adjust themselves to maybe stabilize themselves better or find a way. Or maybe the robot might just honestly break, and the engineers at Boston will have to try again and make one.
Any more questions?
My question is, how, like, on average, how long does it take to like code and create the robots like Spot?
So those robots take years actually to create. Well, to be honest, it doesn't take years to create, but the thing is, they're never really done in a way. So maybe when they're done building the robot, they're constantly adding on to the programming of the robot, and so maybe they'll test it out. They might find out that there is maybe a bug in the code, or maybe it might not be able to do a certain task, and they'll bring it back, fix what was broken, and now program it. So it takes a good amount of time. I'm pretty sure that video with the robot dancing actually took 9 months to do, but I would assume Spot takes a shorter amount of time than Apple.
And we have time for one more question on here.
My question is, do you think there's any like place for AI in like creative jobs, I guess?
What do you mean by creative jobs?
Well, like, I think I heard about something related to this, but like in the arts fields and stuff, do you think there's in the future going to be any place for that in those kinds of jobs?
Yeah, that's an interesting question. I think that artificial intelligence will kind of split its way into the majority of the hobbies that humans have. So there are actually already many forms of art. Like, I was talking with John T the other day actually about how some artificial intelligence softwares are actually created was made by a person or by a computer system. So yes, I do think it will take place in the area pretty soon.
Okay, thank you so much, Derek. Next up, we have Heidi. How we can possibly solve plastic pollution or even cure Alzheimer's. Maybe you've thought about devoting countless hours into cleaning out the plastic, and you probably couldn't come up with a way to cure Alzheimer's. Well, I'm here to tell you that artificial intelligence is the way to go in order to solve these kinds of problems. Before we understand how AI is capable of achieving all of this, we must first understand protein. Proteins are molecules in our bodies and in nature that are that carry out essential functions. They're kind of like little tiny machines in our bodies that can do functions like digesting food, distributing nutrients, protecting us from viruses, and much more. In fact, as I'm standing here, proteins are working hard to allow me to see all of you and move my muscles so that I can talk. Amino acids are the building blocks of proteins, and proteins are generally made up with 50 to 2,000 amino acids strung together like beads on a string. These strings go through a process called protein folding. This is the way that these chains get twisted and bent into its final form to make the protein. These structures are extremely important because the structure of the protein is what ultimately defines what the protein can do. And this is important in our lives in terms of scientific advancements because drugs and vaccines are developed by discovering how the viral proteins interact with substances, and scientists can then discover and create substances that prevent the protein from functioning and hence preventing disease. The discovering the amino acid sequence is quite trivial nowadays thanks to DNA sequencing technology. But the folding process itself is not so simple. These strings of amino acids can fold within a couple milliseconds into an inconceivable number of possible configurations, which makes it incredibly difficult to figure out the structure of the protein. Despite how important proteins are, any mistake in the folding process will cause the protein to not function properly, since a protein will not have the structure, the correct structure for it to function. Even small, seemingly insignificant changes can be the determining factor of whether or not a person suffers from a disease. These structures need to be incredibly precise, which led to the scientists hypothesizing that there must be something in nature that dictates how proteins fold, so that the proteins fold in the correct way each time. This leads us to the protein folding problem. The protein folding problem seeks to determine the structure of the protein just by using the amino acid sequence. Previously, laboratory techniques tried to determine protein structure directly by solving the structure of the protein. And the most popular method was by using a crystal of a protein and determining the location of each atom by how light reflects off of the crystal structure. While these methods are accurate, they also cost hundreds of thousands of dollars and can take months, possibly even years, to determine just one structure. Over the past 60 years of using laboratory techniques, scientists have discovered 180,000 protein structures out of the 200 million plus protein sequences that have been developed, that have been discovered. That's less than 0.1%. This is why it's important to find a faster way of discovering protein structure and trying to solve the structure by only by using amino acid sequence is where AlphaFold comes in. AlphaFold is an artificial intelligence system capable of predicting protein structure in just hours and possibly even minutes with accuracy comparable to those of laboratory techniques. It's an algorithm, so it follows a set of rules and procedures to solve the problem of protein structure. It was developed by Google's DeepMind, which is a team that is devoted to advancements in the field of artificial intelligence. You might know them for developing AlphaGo, the system that beat one of the world's best Go players. AlphaFold was first presented in a competition that aims to expedite the process of predicting protein structure called CASP, or Critical Assessment of Protein Structure Prediction. In this competition, teams are asked to predict the structure of a known yet not publicly released protein structure, and each model is then scored on accuracy. On a scale of 0 to 100, AlphaFold achieved a median score of 92.4, and any score above a 90 is considered to be as accurate as laboratory results, meaning that any score above a 90 is now worth devoting millions of dollars into usage for scientific advancements. This is incredibly impressive, considering over the past 27 years that this competition has been held for, models have rarely achieved a score over 60, and AlphaFold has succeeded to achieve it with errors as small as the width of one singular atom. On the left, you see the ranking of all the models that entered the 2020 CASP competition. The second version of AlphaFold, which was entered into the competition, was ranked first, and it significantly outperforms all other models. It even outperforms its first model that was entered into the 2018 competition. We all know that artificial intelligence is capable of a lot of things, such as predicting the weather or recognizing our speech. But we also know that it's incapable of doing a lot of things, such as distinguishing between poodles and fried chicken. So the fact that a system that can't properly determine these trivial, tangible concepts can predict something as complex and even abstract as protein structure is quite revolutionary and, quite frankly, mind-blowing. This is the official diagram for the structure that AlphaFold 2 takes. I will not go too in-depth into this diagram in particular because, honestly, it would need an entire lecture on its own. But I do want to talk about how AlphaFold 2 differs from previous models that use computers and artificial intelligence. So one previous method divides the amino acid sequence into smaller sections and tries to find corresponding parts in known protein structures and kind of just puts all of them back together. This is not an accurate approach considering some of those sections might not fit together. It's kind of like trying to get a puzzle piece from all these different puzzle sets and expecting them to work together. That's just not how things work. Another approach that has been taken is by assigning values to the distance and angles between adjacent amino acids in a sequence. This approach does not work either because you cannot try to determine the location of one amino acid just by using the one right beside it, because just because two amino acids are far apart in the sequence doesn't mean that it won't be close together when folded into the final 3D structure. So both of these approaches fail to consider the bigger picture in terms of the protein structure. AlphaFold 2, on the other hand, takes a slightly different approach.
It first searches a database of all the known sequences to find sequences that are similar to the one that is in question. This is possible because proteins that carry out specific functions, regardless of the organism that it comes from, takes on similar sequences and similar structures because, again, the structure of the protein determines the function. So after getting kind of a list of similar sequences and structures, the algorithm takes two paths. The first path compares the sequence in question with all the similar sequences that it found, and the second path creates a template or an initial representation of the structure using a known structure, and it takes note of all the distances of all possible pairs of amino acids, not just ones that are adjacent to each other, which, unlike other models, allows this model to get the bigger picture of the structure. Then the two paths try to pinpoint possible interactions between all amino acids, and they run parallel to each other, and they share information with each other to update all the data accordingly, which leads to an output of a refined version of the two sets of information. All of that information is then directly translated into a 3D structure for a final output of a long list of 3D Cartesian coordinates that can then be graphed in order to determine the final 3D structure. One aspect of AlphaFold 2 that's especially important is how it optimizes its results by recycling the output three times through the entire cycle. This allows the system to make constant incremental improvements. This is important because if all the coordinates are calculated at once, then sometimes the 3D coordinates are contradictory in that logically they cannot be graphed together. And that was a problem for a lot of the previous models. But AlphaFold 2 fixes that by iterating through all these steps multiple times to catch those little mistakes each time for a more accurate result. So what does this mean? Well, AlphaFold 2 has already successfully predicted over 350,000 protein structures, including 99% of all proteins in the human body, when previously only about 17% have been known. And the team, the DeepMind team, is looking to expand that number to over 100 million. This immensely broadens the possibilities of drug and vaccine research, since as we discover more and more protein structures of harmful proteins in less time, we can better understand certain diseases. Diseases such as Alzheimer's and certain types of cancer are caused by proteins that don't fold properly. So understanding the structure of those proteins can ultimately benefit the research towards developing a cure for those types of diseases. Another interesting use of protein structure is protein design, meaning by using a known protein structure that performs a specific function, scientists can manipulate that protein into performing the same function but in a different context. Most notably, it has been proposed that the protein in the human body that breaks down harmful chemicals can be manipulated, and a new protein can be designed to mimic that protein to apply in nature, where they can break down toxic chemicals and possibly even plastic. On top of all those benefits, all the information about AlphaFold are public, and they were released a couple months ago in July 2021. DeepMind's goal was to make artificial intelligence more accessible to people, and they are achieving this by allowing open access to code, so any one of us can run the algorithm if we want to. Although it does require you to painstakingly download 2.5 terabytes of database. So don't do it on your laptops, but it is possible. They also have an AlphaFold protein structure database, which houses all the predictions that the system has made. And again, it will expand as the system continues to make more predictions. This will facilitate any and all developments and advancements relating to proteins, and scientists will no longer need millions of dollars and years of time to figure out the structure of proteins. Despite this amazing achievement, AlphaFold 2 does not come without its shortcomings. It still leaves one big question open, which is, why do proteins fold the way they do? AlphaFold falls a little short in figuring out the answer to this problem, and scientists will continue to investigate how and why proteins fold the way they do, but AlphaFold 2 provides a significant step towards that solution in providing a relationship between amino acid sequences and the final protein structure. Another flaw is that AlphaFold, while extremely accurate, they're still predictions. Some predictions did not achieve an accuracy score of 90, and while DeepMind will make an effort to create a more consistently accurate algorithm, when it comes to protein structure, we can't really afford any mistakes. So that is one drawback. And speaking of accuracy, it is yet to be determined if the algorithm will perform equally as well if there is limited data. We all now know that AlphaFold depends heavily on known data in terms of known sequences and structures. And DeepMind has admitted that if the algorithm does not have at least 30 different sequences to compare to the sequence in question, the accuracy drops substantially. Another flaw is that AlphaFold is not capable of predicting multi-protein complexes. These complexes are linked proteins that interact with each other to perform essential functions, and AlphaFold at its current state is not capable of determining these complexes, which is a significant drawback considering a lot of drug discovery processes require the structure of multi-protein complexes. AlphaFold comes with its flaws, but it doesn't take away from the fact that it is an incredible achievement that is putting us in a significantly more advanced position than we were in just a couple of years ago. It's absolutely fascinating how biology and nature can combine with artificial intelligence, which is pretty much the opposite of nature, to complement each other and create this tool that can revolutionize the fields of biology and artificial intelligence and ultimately change the world for the better. Thank you. In terms of the actual algorithm, when the structure is not known, I'm not exactly sure how the confidence score is determined, but the algorithm does produce a confidence score that kind of shows how much, how the algorithm thinks the protein structure is, would be the right protein structure. I'm not quite sure how the algorithm calculates it, but there is a confidence score that ultimately comes out with the output.
Any other questions? Yes, at the back, Helen.
Hey, Ryan. So I was just wondering if you could elaborate a little bit on the use of these proteins and like manipulating them to potentially break down plastics. And I was wondering like what the result would be, like what the plastics would kind of turn into. Would they just be like similar molecules, or like how would that work?
From what I've read, I believe that because the manipulated protein will mimic the proteins in our body that breaks down toxic chemicals, we all know how toxins get released out of our bodies. So I believe that the manipulated protein will also produce some sort of decomposable output. From the plastic or toxic chemical that it breaks down.
Thank you.
Any more questions? Yes.
I was just wondering how exactly knowing the protein structures of certain diseases will help find cures to that.
Yeah. So if we're taking like cancer for an example, there are proteins in our bodies that suppress, there are proteins that suppress tumors. So sometimes those proteins kind of malfunction in that they don't take on the right structure. And that kind of just means that that protein will no longer prevent tumors from forming. So while simply knowing the protein structure is not going to like provide a direct cure, it kind of brings light to how scientists can potentially create a substance that can fix the problem of that misfolded protein, since now we know the structure and at what points of the proteins the malformations happen.
Thank you.
One more question, if anyone has one, before we move on. Okay. Well then, thank you again to Heidi.
Why on earth we should start caring about it. Tonight's presentation is inspired by the research of my team at the Summer Science Program and its astrophysics track of 2021, to whom I'd like to extend my deepest gratitude. So let's get started with the big idea. The Earth is a giant rock that orbits the sun. All right, sure, we're a bit of a pretty rock. We got the nice blue and the green and the white. We're pretty. But otherwise, we're still a rock. We're a rock that's floating in space, that's orbiting the sun. We have rocks that are similar in size to us, maybe a little bigger, maybe a little smaller. We call those planets. But then we have rocks that are relatively much smaller than these asteroids. And they are called asteroids, like I just said. These asteroids have an ability to have more of a free orbit. And when I say free orbit, I mean that because of their small size, they can be easily influenced by the gravitational forces of other planets. In our solar system, for example, Jupiter, being the largest planet, has a gravitational force that's relatively a lot stronger than per se Earth's. So when an asteroid is sort of going to be passing by in its orbit near Jupiter, it can very easily get influenced. These asteroids then become a problem, because like our friends, roughly 625,000 years ago, we wouldn't want to end up like them.
at the point when no scissor was strong enough to fight a rock like this one. So that's how my journey with asteroids began. I was very curious as to, of course, 625,000 years ago, we didn't have the technology, we didn't have any understanding, we weren't around to figure out how to deal with these asteroids. At SSP, we were divided, 36 of us, into teams of three, so that meant 12 groups. My group went down to two, so it was just me and my partner. We studied 2003 HB6, that is the name of the asteroid, the first asteroid you'll hear about tonight. 2003 HB6 is a near-Earth asteroid. A near-Earth asteroid is defined as one whose orbital path, or its path that it takes in space, intersects our path as Earth's orbit in space. To give you a reference, there's roughly 27,000 near-Earth asteroids that have been discovered by NASA and by other space observatories across the world already. That's 27,000 relatively small, yet still pretty powerful rocks, just floating around, casually intersecting our orbit every now and then. This right here to your right is an artist's rendition of such an asteroid. It is not a real image, it's rather just, it's a typical rock that you think of. Now here, for reference, let me get you an understanding of what 2003 HB6 looks like in reality. This right here is an image out of a set of 9 images that my team and I collected over the course of our summer observing sessions. Roughly taken around 3:45 a.m. Eastern time. Lots of coffee, luckily. This right here that you see, this aperture, and that if you look really closely, I apologize for those in the back, there's a small little gray pixel. That right there is 2003 HB6. That tiny little dot in this massive star field that we see is one of the 27,000 near-Earth asteroids that could potentially become a threat to Earth. Now, this looks pretty cool, it's just an image, but what do we make of this? What are we trying to do here today? Let's go further and look at all 9. So right here, you see a star field. It's the same one, but now you have a set of 9 images. I'm gonna try to follow that dot as it goes. Apologize again to those in the back, but you can see that out of everything else, it's fairly constant, and then there's this one little dot that's sort of moving across like a little speck of dust in the rest of the star field. That right there is 2003 HB6 over a course of 9 images. What did we just do? It says it kind of underneath. We found the position. Big thumbs up right there. We have the first data point that we need in terms of actually determining the orbit of this asteroid. And that leads into the main goal of tonight, orbit determination, or OD for short. It's a bit of a mouthful. Let's just call it OD. Orbit determination takes the data points of position and uses them to determine the orbital elements. The orbital elements are 6 measurable parameters that make orbits unique. Out of the 6 that we're going to see here right now, I put 2 in blue. 2 in blue are the ones that we're going to focus for tonight and for the sake of time. These 2, in my understanding, have been the most important in understanding how this orbit moves in space. The first being semi-major axis and the second one being eccentricity, E. A and E are the variables that we will use to refer to them. The first 2 are responsible for shaping the Earth's, for shaping the asteroid's orbit. The following 4, which I'd love to talk about at another time, actually have to do with the tilt and the plane at which the asteroid orbits. But for now, all we're trying to do is take the shape of the asteroid's orbit to use it to visualize the orbit in a way that we understand it. So let's understand what I mean by shaping the orbit. Let's start off by clarifying a very common misconception that a lot of us might have, that our orbits are perfect circles. They indeed are not. So let's think about it in that sense, where we have the semi-major axis, A. A is the distance between the asteroid and its primary focus. In our case, that's the sun. So the distance between this asteroid and the sun, because this asteroid is also orbiting the sun. Even in our case on Earth, that sort of semi-major axis is the distance, is roughly, as an approximation, the distance between Earth and the sun. Eccentricity, or E, is a ratio that describes how elongated an ellipse is. Elongated feels like a little hard to visualize. I like to think of it as just how squashed the ellipse is. Eccentricity is a value that you can only find between 0 and 1. If E is equal to 0, we have a perfectly circular orbit, which we have yet to find in space. If E is equal to 1, we have a parabolic orbit, which yet again, in terms of our near-Earth asteroids, we have yet to figure out. Therefore, E will always be a value between 0 and 1. Okay,
So now we have a good understanding. We know the two orbital elements that we need. We have our position. Are we good to go? Are we done for the night? No, not yet. Apologies. We're going to bring out our calculators. And at this point, unfortunately, I cannot bring up Desmos for you or your TI-84 because they will simply crash with the amount of data that we have to process. Python will be our savior for the day. And simply put, having calculated the position from our different observing sessions that we did at 3:45 in the morning, we will plug those into Python, having coded all of this. This is just one screenshot. This was roughly around 800 to 900 lines of code by the end. So like Derek said very well, it's a lot of code, it takes a long time. This took roughly 6 weeks to process as a whole. And so the last two lines here, we have A and E, using the position and the velocity that we calculate of the asteroid's motion in space, we are able to determine these values. All right, we got somewhere. We got the calculated orbital elements. Again, the first two being semi-major axis and eccentricity. And the bottom four, again, since they determine the tilt, we have them all in degree measures, and we can definitely talk about that at a different time. But back up to semi-major axis A for a second. The value that we're getting here is 2.71 AU. AU feels like a new unit to a lot of us. Simply put, miles and kilometers are simply too small of a unit to work in space. And therefore, we're going to use astronomical units, or AU. Let's think of it like this. 1 AU is roughly equal to the distance between the Earth, the average distance between Earth and the Sun. That's pretty far. It's a pretty big distance, so 1 AU is pretty big. This asteroid orbits semi-major axis, or sort of that point between the Sun and the asteroid on average, is 2.71 times greater than the average distance between Earth and the Sun. This orbit, simply put, is huge in our comparison. Eccentricity, again, being that value between 0 and 1, just describes how elongated this ellipse is, or how squashed it is. In this case, relative, but it is sort of squashed like this, in the sense that, you know, it's being stretched so far this way that it's being squashed, and that's how we end up shaping the orbit. And then the following four are going to be able to help us understand its tilt. But for now, let's just focus on A and E. So, all right, we got the elements, you know, we ran the code, we're doing great, but I told you that I wanted to visualize this stuff. All my friends at SSP said that they wanted to visualize this stuff. We're pretty good at coding, but this was where we just sort of sat there on Zoom and were like, now what? In comes SWIRI. No, not Siri, but SWIRI, the Southwest Research Institute. It is a private research facility and organization based in San Antonio, Texas. But they have a team in Boulder, Colorado of roughly 80 researchers that bring together all the work that I presented to you with all the other complexities that we left out for the purpose of today's talk. And they do it for way far more than just one asteroid that we're discussing right now. They do this every single day. They are able to provide us with these animations. So basically, they have another whole chunk of code, roughly 2,000-3,000 lines worth of code. You know, we were proud of our 900, they have like 3,000 lines of code running for just this visualization here. And simply put, what it does is we're gonna take all the data that we calculated, all those orbital elements, plug them into their code, and we get this visualization here. Don't panic, it's continuously looping, so even when we get to it at any point, you'll still see it. On your left here, we have one graph. They're both the same graphs, rather, just at different time frames. The one on your left is roughly representing 1,000 years per frame. So almost every time you're blinking, 1,000 years are going by, sometimes even faster. On the right side, we have 50,000 years per frame. Every time you're blinking, 50,000 years are flying by just like that. The sort of blue dots that you see on the bottom on both things, on both graphs, represent various planets in our solar system in proximity to the Sun, going from left to right. So the leftmost blue dot is actually Venus. Earth is the middle one, right at 1.0. You sort of get the idea. 1 AU being the average distance from Earth to the Sun represents that blue dot right there as Earth, that is Earth's average distance. Following that, we have Mars, and then Jupiter, and then Saturn. All the red lines close those dots you see are 100 simulations of this asteroid's potential orbit. One simulation is what its orbit is according to the day of our observation, which was roughly July 13th of 2021. 99 of those other simulations are actually predictions of what happens when this asteroid perhaps comes near Jupiter or gets influenced by Venus or simply even is ejected from our solar system due to other gravitational attractions. So, as you're looking closely, we see a lot of interaction, especially in this left one, with that sort of fourth planet going from left to right, and that actually is Jupiter. So again, Jupiter being the largest planet, having the strongest gravitational attraction, is pulling a lot of these asteroid simulations, and is more likely to pull the asteroid towards itself. But when we look at Earth, that sort of blue dot just sitting at 1.0, nothing's really happening. It's sort of very calm. You know, we don't see any red lines coming near it, and that actually is a good sign. So out of those 100 simulations, we can now actually take a deep breath and arrive at this conclusion, that 2003-HP6 is unlikely to hit Earth for at least another 23.4 million years. Yes, take that deep breath. I think we earned it. But I told you, there's always a bug, guys, come on. This is one out of 27,000 near Earth asteroids. Since we're done with one, we can't sit down like the dinosaurs, right? Can't do that just yet. With that, I'd like you to meet Bennu. Bennu is an actually photographed asteroid. It's sort of the talk of the town these days. It's sort of that rock that's a little more important than all the other rocks, and I think we can all start guessing why. Bennu is a near-Earth asteroid that has been determined to have a sort of chance of coming near Earth, and rather very soon too. This is not a doomsday talk. I'm giving you that disclaimer right now. We will fight through this like we fought through HP6. We will get through this one as well. I'll give you some reference though, not to sort of build on your fear. 2003 HP6 was just this tiny little pixel. Bennu, we have some more data on it. Bennu roughly weighs 98 billion kilograms. Still a little hard to visualize sometimes. All right, I'll tell you. The radius of Bennu is 861 feet, roughly. Let's keep going. If you were to imagine the Empire State Building in the city of New York, this asteroid stands taller than the entire Empire State Building. It's pretty powerful. You know that tiny rock, that relatively small rock? Not that tiny anymore. So here's what we're going to do now. Rather than panic and you know, worry, we're going to follow that same iterative process now at a bit of a faster rate. So we're going to find the position and velocity. We're going to run it through our orbital elements, so our Python code. And then we run those elements through Sweary's code. And we're able to determine whether or not it has a chance of hitting Earth. So through some of that work, we were able to find a rough estimate of what Bennu's orbit looks like. So if the blue is the Earth, the blue circle is, or sorry, the blue ellipse rather, is the Earth, then the green ellipse is Bennu. So you can see that, you know, yes, Bennu has sort of a larger orbit, but it's also intersecting with Earth in more than one place, intersecting with Earth's orbit. So in this case, you know, we have sort of Earth floating in a different location at the time. Hopefully it stays that way. But we have an active asteroid that is intersecting our orbit more than once. Something to think about as we keep going. But you know what? Let's actually think about the data. So, knowing that this was one of the more dangerous or more talk of the town type asteroids, NASA and their facility at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory in Pasadena, California, were actually able to conduct that same type of study, just in far more detail, and were able to determine the semi-major axis and eccentricity values, which we have right up there. Now, taking these values, we take them to be, you know, fairly precise, considering that they've had a lot more, this data has been checked a lot more than just, you know, ours from SSP. We'll take this data, so we'll take the eccentricity value and the semi-major axis, and we're gonna run it through Sweary again. So, remember in 2003-HP6, 0 out of 100 of the simulations ever crashed into Earth, and we took a deep sigh of relief. Here we are with Bennu. 1 out of 1,750 of those simulations crashed, or collided rather, with Earth in the next 300 years. That's roughly a chance of 0.06%. So now that I'm sort of playing with your fear a little bit, let me just add to that really quickly before I dismiss it. If I were to place a jar of 1,750 candies in front of you, told you to put your hand in, just take one out and enjoy it for the evening, but one of those candies could hurt you, could potentially harm you, you'd probably think a little. You'd hesitate, just a little bit. I know you would. And that is really what asteroid orbit determination is about. It's that slightest hesitancy, it's that sort of less than 1% chance that we need to be mindful of. Because when, of course, the dinosaurs had no ability to, but that sort of less than 1% chance is the reason we find fossils. Theoretically, the reason we find fossils everywhere. course, I told you I was going to play with your fear, but I promised you that it wasn't going to be a doomsday talk. That is because, as always, our hero and savior, NASA, so good at with their space exploration, but also with a deep commitment to planetary defense, has a plan. That plan is called DART, the Double Asteroid Redirection Test. DART is actually a planned mission set to take off from 12 days from now, that is November 24th, this year. It is a spacecraft that is designed as a test to collide with an asteroid quite far from Earth in case anything goes wrong. And we would like to actually be able to redirect the asteroid. So once we have a confirmation through multiple phases of asteroid orbit determination, or OD, that an asteroid is coming our way, can we redirect it through a collision? The spacecraft will obviously be remote operated. We're not going to endure any loss in that sense, except of course the material and the spacecraft, and of course the financial aspect of it as well. But while the spacecraft will probably be obliterated to bits, we might be able to redirect the asteroid into a different direction very intentionally so that it doesn't impact us. This test, like I said, is set to launch in 12 days. It will roughly reach the asteroid, and the collision is expected to be on October 2nd, 2022. I will have graduated by then, but I will send you an email and let you know what happens. But also, check it out, and we'll see. So, we're at this point now where we see a problem. We have a test solution, and we're going to keep working with that. If NASA's test succeeds in October, we now have a viable solution to the next asteroid that's coming our way. But even if it doesn't, what I'm here today to say is that we can do something about it. That even if NASA's plan doesn't, if NASA's first plan doesn't work, the second plan will, there's got to be ways that we can redirect asteroids so that they don't hit us. That we can take our fate into our own hands, that we can have our planetary defense advance to the point that we can truly keep this planet safe in terms of the hundreds of rocks or the thousands of rocks that are floating around us. And similarly, every asteroid out there has its own fate, its own destiny, its own path. Its path gets rather influenced by many of the gravitational attractions of other planets. Similarly, I think of living things and the human race on this planet. We have our own we have our own destinies, we have our own fates. But I think with the advancement of technology that we can sort of influence that destiny and really be able to protect ourselves from becoming the next dinosaurs. Thank you.
Okay, I think this might be working again temporarily. Thank you, Sonal. Questions for Sonal?
So, hypothetically, if there was an asteroid of that size, like you said, you're talking about the Empire State Building, how much damage would that do to Earth?
Yeah, so there's two ways to think about that. I mean, one is sort of the immediate damage. So, I mean, frankly, the city of New York would no longer be the city of New York. You would, and being that it is a city on the water, any collision sort of on that lower island of Manhattan can actually cause a massive impact on the water around it as well, which can send shock waves and it can cause massive tsunamis in that instance as well. But there's also just another set of impact. Our Earth, not to go into too much of geology, but it sits on a set of tectonic plates on the crust, and these plates are constantly shifting. So such a massive collision with 98 million kilograms is the approximated weight of Bennu, and if that is to slam into one of the tectonic plates, it would cause a lot of seismic activity, which we can then think of as earthquakes and more tsunamis. And that would sort of send ripple effects all across the Atlantic Ocean. I'm not the scientist behind this, but I can make an educated guess that we would very, very soon see impacts all the way over Europe as well, and most definitely all of the entire East Coast. And just in that sense, the ripple effects will keep continuing, and the effects in that sense long term will only continue to get worse, because in that sense we've sort of permanently damaged the tectonic plates beneath us that keep us standing on the ground that we are today. Thank you.
Other questions for Sino? Come to you in a minute.
So, you said that we saw some video of the first asteroid. How did they actually find it in space?
Okay, so that was a part of the talk that for the purpose of time we had to leave out, but it's actually in a lot of collaboration with JPL, so the Jet Propulsion Laboratory. So out of a majority of the near-Earth asteroids that we at SSP were also discovering, some data has already been collected on them. We weren't, you know, unfortunately we weren't sort of like fresh into like finding a brand new asteroid. There was a little bit of data, and again, much appreciation to JPL for that. They were sort of able to approximate it's like roughly where the location could be, and then it was on us to sort of continue that forward and actually be able to find it. So what you actually saw back there in that image was a star field zoomed in by a lot, so a lot of the things in the background were a lot of massive stars and like planets or satellites, but they were sort of stationary in motion, and that was because of how farther away they were. And the only reason that we were able to find our asteroid is once you take a series of 9 images, then you look for that one tiny thing that's moving. And that is sort of the physics behind it, in that all the other objects, celestial bodies in space, are so far away, and then there's that one little pixel that is sort of freely moving across those 9 images, and that right there is our asteroid.
Well, thank you for the presentation, that was amazing. I have a bit of a doomsday question. Is there any possibility DART is gonna knock something else into Earth while it's in space?
See, that is actually a really, really good question, in that DART, it is a test, and the reason that we picked the sort of asteroid that, that NASA picked the asteroid they did, and you know, we can sort of start to intuitively bring it together, is that one, it takes a little less than a year to even get there and sort of cause this collision. This asteroid is very, very far away from us. And in my understanding, if something were to go wrong, which I mean, unfortunately things, you know, that's just what happens, things might go wrong. It's that the effect will hopefully not be as imminent on Earth. I don't think that, it is very unlikely that a collision will cause it to sort of speed up in our direction, but rather it will go in the opposite direction. The collision, in fact, is actually planned so that it moves even further away from Earth. It's already super far away, but the collision is expected to go that way. So even if something goes wrong, it might go a little here, but hopefully not back to us. And I mean, if it does, then we can have a different doomsday conversation. I hope and pray that that doesn't happen. I think NASA's been able to plan it to that much precision and accuracy, but the rest we can be glued to our screens on October 2nd, and then we can reconvene.
Thank you.
I was just wondering how fast and accurate can like programs like NASA and other programs identify NEAs? Like, or in other words, is there any possibility that an asteroid can enter our orbit without us noticing? Like, yeah.
So that risk is definitely there, although with the advancements of technology and with the countless number of satellites that are in space, including our International Space Station, I think that if it's to enter our orbit, we would very much know. We have hundreds of observatories across Earth. We have hundreds of telescopes and satellites meant for space exploration and space studies up in space. And at this point in the 21st century, I think it would be highly unlikely that we sort of miss an asteroid coming our way. Unless, of course, it's sort of like a really, really small thing that sort of just, you know, just slides by. But I think that if it were to be one that is potentially dangerous, something like Bennu, and if it was coming our way, I think I'm very, very sure that we can be able to detect it before it's too late.
One more question to finish.
Hey Sonal, so you talked about how the code took like a long time for you guys to put all the information in and stuff. I just wondered if you knew if like NASA and other space observatories had like other languages that may make that quicker, like are there faster ways of doing that? Obviously they have like huge teams to do it, but I was just wondering if like the fact that you guys did it with Python like maybe made
Okay, frankly, I'm so glad you asked that, because that was something that I really wanted to talk about in the purpose of this talk, but then again, due to time constraints, that was something that we had to move out for that moment. But Python is actually really, really good for scientific and mathematical calculations. It has a bunch of different libraries that we can download that have already been pre-coded that can help do these calculations. Like, for example, to all of our calculus students, you can actually take derivatives and follow all the rules of calculus just through Python. So even at NASA, they do utilize other languages as well, sort of, again, on that high end of programming. But typically, Python is very, very powerful. And in terms of speed, developing the code, like the fellow presenters actually talked about, does take a long time. But processing that code on a computer like mine, I have like a casual math book, it takes a very long time just because of processing speed and software power. But at NASA, at SWIRI, like you were wondering, they have supercomputers. These supercomputers are massive. They have a much stronger capacity to process this type of code, and they do it much faster. In fact, the 100 simulations that I ran off my computer and my partner ran off his, both of us having MacBooks, took roughly 4 days to process. So our computers are just running, and you can hear the fan just churning every single day. If you take the power off, you know your computer's gone forever and ever. We just sat there, let it happen, and prayed as much as possible to get some data. SWIRI and NASA, on the other hand, can do like 1,750 simulations. That's because of the supercomputer power. It's just, I could have asked my computer to do 1,750 simulations, but then I wouldn't be able to submit my physics homework each night.
Okay, thank you, Sonal. So I don't think I need to tell you how much time and effort clearly went into these incredible presentations. So I just want to end by saying thank you so much to our finalists. You all did such a fantastic job, and I think we deserve a really big round of applause for them. Results at school meeting next week. Please head straight back to dorm and go check in.